to belong to some society, to some family. This is something that always makes us united, because comparing that, all the time we are running by solo practicing, solo lessons, doing, improving. And these events are doing something more, mostly like family life for bass.
Welcome to another episode of Contrabass Conversations, your show covering life on the low end of the spectrum. I'm your host, Jason Heath. So glad to have you here today. Check out everything that's going on at ContrabassConversations.com. I'd love to hear from you. Send me an email, feedback@ContrabassConversations.com. Let me know a little bit about yourself, where you're from, where you play, all those kind of details. I'd love to learn a little bit more about you. And I know you're going to love today's episode. Coming from Prague 2016, I'm chatting with Petia Bagovska. And Petia, I've known for years. She teaches at the Sofia National Music Academy in Bulgaria. Sofia, Bulgaria. She plays all over the world, teaches all over the world. She was in Prague, and it was so great to catch up with her again. Because I actually used to work with her in Chicago. We played in some orchestras together when we were both living there. And it was so much fun to sit down. And these conversations this week, I'm talking with Petia today, and we're going to feature an episode with Florian Pertzborn from Porto, Portugal, later on this week. And we'll round off the week with a chat with two expats that we had such a good time catching up and really geeking out about extensions and bass capos. Rob Anzalotti of BassCapos.com and Chris Mathers. All of this took place in Prague. So before I get going with Petia's episode, I just want to set the scene. We're sitting in a beautiful courtyard in the center of Prague at the HAMU, the music school there. People are drinking coffee, they're drinking beer, they're eating a snack, they're chatting, they're having a good time. I couldn't be happier. Every day I was there, I woke up and thought, I'm in Prague. This is sweet. Life is good. And it was so great to chat with Petia a little bit about Bulgaria, growing up there, Sofia. All these conversations this week are kind of like wide-eyed American observing the wider world, I guess, conversations. So it's a lot of me being really curious about how things differ in Europe as opposed to the U.S., where I've been living, and the podcast has been very U.S.-centric the first 9.5 years. So I'm really looking forward to expanding out. I think this is country number 23 that I'll have featured a guest from. We'll also have a couple tracks from Petia's album, One Bass, One Woman. And check out the show notes for links for everything that Petia's up to. I'd also like to thank our sponsor, D'Addario Strings. And you can hear me playing my set of D'Addario Zayek strings in the background here. I'm really liking these strings. They're great for arco. They're great for pizzicato. They've got a nice growl. They're good hybrid strings. I do a lot of both styles of playing, and I love them. D'Addario just set up a string giveaway for Contrabass Conversations listeners. And I'll have a link in the show notes for this, but you can go to ContrabassConversations.com/strings. If you're in the car or you're on the treadmill or you're doing dishes or whatever, ContrabassConversations.com/strings. Fill out some information. You'll be enrolled in a string giveaway, which is very cool. One of the many things that I've been talking about with them going forward with the podcast. Okay, here we go with our interview with Petia Bagovska. It's so good to talk to you. Can you let people know a little bit about how you started playing the double bass?
Good question. Actually, in the past, I started early in the childhood time performing piano. Mm-hmm. And I was not good enough with piano, so the teacher said to my parents, she's very musical, that's why she has to go with some music education for the future, but she's not ready to attend the music school, because we have, in Russian, they have absolutely specific music schools that you can enter with exam. You couldn't go just there if you want. No, you have to enter, and we have a system of having 5 or 6 music schools in Bulgaria. So you have to cover all what is necessary to be like material for the exam, and then you can attend the school.
Okay.
Even then, they are starting from first grade, from fourth grade, after seventh grade, and they are finishing high school with absolutely specified music schools as a professional one.
Okay.
So I was not ready with piano, and that's why I just jumped to the bass. It was not my choice. It was a choice of teacher. He said that maybe it will go for her, because his daughter, actually, she was the principal of opera orchestra in Sofia, and he said that she's very successful, so it will be interesting if I can have some lessons with her and then go on with the double bass.
Okay. Wow. Most people listening probably haven't been to Sofia before. Is there a symphony orchestra, an opera orchestra? What does the music scene look like there?
Okay, especially Sofia, or about Bulgaria?
Well, maybe Bulgaria in general.
Yes. We have, almost every big city has at least 1 or 2 orchestras.
Mm-hmm.
I think we have, we are about 8 million people, and we have probably over 40 orchestras that they are state orchestras, over 40. And it's a good system, because when we have these music schools and after Academy of Music, and the best are just going to, of course, to the best orchestras, maybe not only in Sofia and Bulgaria, but also abroad.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a good system for for education in music, a good old tradition. And in Sofia, we have, I think, about 10 orchestras. I'm speaking about the old tradition, having state and community orchestras.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We have some private orchestras that they are running up with the projects, earning money, and they do some like festival orchestras. We have FM Classic Festival Orchestra, and also some of them that just are together for building some project.
Mm.
But all the orchestras are paid by the state.
By the state, okay.
Yeah.
And are there, some of those must be opera orchestras and symphony orchestras?
Yes, in Sofia we have actually radio, Philharmony, we have Symphonietta, we have Sofia Soloist Orchestra, we have Music Theater Orchestra, opera also is very big, something like 6 symphonies, orchestras,
okay,
and opera together, and it goes okay. It goes, the problem is that we have really very much ambience public. The life is very dynamic, cultural life in Sofia, especially because we are about 2 million in Sofia. The problem is always the problem of earning enough money.
Sure.
Yeah. The life is almost like here in Prague. It's almost the same standard.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Mm, so you see how it is. You can compare for you. Maybe it is cheap, mm-hmm, but I couldn't say that it's the best time in quality of standard of salaries.
Mm-hmm.
In having many orchestras, it's really a big question.
do people play in more than one orchestra usually, or are they just playing in one orchestra?
Usually they belong to one orchestra.
Just one.
And
okay,
only for private project they go to the other.
Okay.
But they are just staying in one orchestra.
Now, who are some of the bass players that have been the biggest influence on you? Like, who, in terms of people you studied with and people you...
You mean right now or before?
Maybe before, and then we can go...
We have a good school for double bass. Actually, we have tradition close to Czech tradition, because actually my professor, Todor Toše, who was one of the best teachers in the world, I could say, he has studied here in Prague, in this conservatory here, with Audrey Shores, together with František Pošta.
Oh, great, yeah, sure.
They were together, they were friends, and they were absolutely the same level of musicians, of pedagogues, of they had built it after that, their schools in their countries. So having this very old tradition of Czech Republic, and also we had also very good tradition, because the his Asen Vapurjev, his professor, has studied with Nani.
Oh, wow, yeah.
In Paris. And that's how the system of, it was first, it was mostly like German or Czech system of holding the bow. And after that, it changed after, when he came back from Paris, he changed the system of holding the bow. So it had been running on a French bow.
Okay, and then it switched at that point.
Now it's, I think, both, because as I told you, many of my students, they go, and they, one of who is the main teacher in National School of Music, High School of Music in Sofia, now it's Svoboda Bozuganova, and she had also had a master year of master here in Czech. So she run with, she changed the system, she run with the German, and she came, and now she teaches both system.
Okay.
But we have also together French and German.
Sure. Okay. Oh, interesting. And tell us a little bit about the you teach at the conservatory.
I'm in the Academy of Music in Sofia, which is the superior school for music, the highest quality of professional musicians. So the musicians who they are doing their diplomas in the high school. Mm-hmm. Some of them are going abroad. Some of them are just staying in Sofia in the Academy of Music. I have a big class with students. Usually it is around 8 to 10 students.
Okay. Yeah.
And we have good tradition. Usually I'm teaching 3 days, like full classes from through the days. And also they are studying chamber music, orchestra music, all this musical discipline. But it is specified absolutely like Academy of Music, or what they say in German, Hochschule, für Musik. And we have good tradition. We are organizing festivals. The book I'm giving you, you can see what festivals for bass we are organizing, having fun together, playing. We have had many visitors, great professor from Europe, and also from the States. Rob Nairn was our special guest like some years ago. And we do all together. We did some concert with Wolfgang Jutler, performing 16 basses all together for the concert. So it's a challenge.
I played a music festival in Germany, Schleswig-Holstein Music Festival, and Wolfgang Jutler was my coach.
Yes,
and we did 16 basses, West Side Story, and that kind of thing.
Yes, absolutely, like that.
Yeah.
I enjoyed.
That's great.
Yes, always. Yeah. This make you feeling like to belong to some society, to some family. And this is something that always makes us united, because comparing that, all the time we are running by solo practicing, solo lessons, doing, improving. And these events are doing something more, mostly like family life for bass. And we have also international competition in Bulgaria, and now I will be jury in November. It is for two groups of till 19 and after 19. And also we have one which is maybe only one in the world existing in this direction, like only for Bulgarian music works. It is every 2 years, and it includes only Bulgarian music for double bass.
Okay. Okay.
For double bass, it's something like that makes composers to write more.
Sure. Yeah, like contemporary double bass composers.
Pieces like okay. Emil Tabakov, you know. We also play Boris Karadimchev tema with variation, which is one wonderful piece for double bass. And many like others have been written like that for this competition especially. And it's not only for bass, it's for all kind of instruments, but they are changing. I mean, they are just turning. One by one, different instruments every 2 years. And what the live teaching, doing concerts, so we have also musical production, but we have two big concert hall. And the biggest one is it's very special events, and the other one is like two or three times your like a chamber music hall that we can concert hall that we can have concert there enjoying and playing together. Also, what is good in our system that twice in a week we have playing mostly technical stuffs, and the second always obligatory to have a pianist, which is an accompanist, which is belongs to our classes, and we are working every week with the piano player.
Wow,
with
every
pianist
week.
Every week, yes, it's like 4 or 5 times in a month.
That's great.
You can have your repertoire perform with pianist, which is really. You can listen all the music, all the score.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Most schools don't do that. That's great to have that.
We have pianist belongs to the classes. And what we have also in this academy, we have classical, jazz, pop and jazz faculty. And some of our students are doing both classical and pop and jazz.
Okay. Okay.
Which makes them easier to find a job.
Sure, of course, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and the life in Sofia, we have very intensive cultural life. And it's nice to always there are people for some project running around. And it's nice. We have good tradition, and I'm trying to keep them. Well, we are teaching me. I'm the professor, titular of the double bass. And then I have also one colleague who is teaching. His name is Chetomir Lazarov. He also teaches. He also plays in the Sofia Soloist Orchestra. Okay. So we both have classes. So we have about 70 or 20 students of double bass.
That's great. You were mentioning Nanny and the influence. I'd love to know what are some of the common, people always find this interesting, what are some of the materials that people typically work on in the academy? Do you use the Nani method, or what materials do people study?
Well, we are using Nani. He has 10 capriccios. Mm-hmm. We play them by Nani, 10 capriccios for double bass. Also very much Mengoli, okay. Italian books.
Yeah.
Of course, Hrabe and Storch. Mm-hmm. But all of them, like you mean, like mostly like technical.
Yeah, like technical, and then I'd love to know what solo works are common. Anything that you know, we all know Dragonetti and Kusevitsky, but anything maybe that's a little unique.
What else? We do also Jean Francais concert. Also Tubin concerto. It's also nice. Also, we do perform these Bulgarian composers like Emil Tabakov. Also has wonderful concert for double bass.
Okay.
Emil Tabakov. Mm. What else like repertoire? Except what we have, of course, always Dietersdorf for audition.
Sure. Yeah.
Also, we are playing Sperger a lot.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Sonatas, also concertos. František Černý, Even now I included, it's one wonderful elegy. It's like a reverie by Czerny, Czech program. If you ask me about the bigger repertoire for bigger group or chamber music, or what you mean, not except solo or just...
That's great. But yeah, are there any chamber works that we might not be familiar with that are popular in Sofia or in Bulgaria?
Like chamber music.
Because we all play the Beethoven septet or the, you know, Dvorak quintet.
Yeah. This is Prokofiev quintet.
Prokofiev,
also.
Yeah.
Forel quintet, yeah, Schubert. But especially, yes, now it's also arpeggione they do.
Okay,
they
that's
like
popular,
to
yeah.
do also. Yeah. What else? It's like chamber music. At the moment, what else? But they are doing also transcription. They are not so many original works.
Sure.
So, like, for example, one of my students, he's crazy about to do Rachmaninoff trio.
Oh, okay. All right. Wow.
Yes, so with pianist and violin. What about, yeah.
No, that's great. Well, there's plenty. There are several names there that... I'm not familiar with, so I got to go do my research and look. Now, we met, it was a while ago. I think it was probably like 10 years ago. We met in Chicago.
Yes.
Actually, and you've done all sorts of traveling, and it's exciting what you've done. Maybe just tell folks a little bit about what you've done outside of the country.
Okay. I spent something like 3 years I spent in Finland. So when I saw Teppu Hautaho, we were speaking in Finnish, it was nice to remember. Even now I have visited in May the school of Sibelius in Helsinki. I was invited to have a masterclass there now in May. And you can see how they grew up so many, many talented bass players. What else? I have visited also Turkey, Greece. So we have with Vasilis Papvasiliou some projects to make like summer classes, local summer classes. But almost also having this time, I mean, my time is before America and after America, you mean?
Okay, yeah, sure, okay.
It was also a big challenge to be there. I never will forget this marvelous time in Chicago Pops Orchestra, what I had with the biggest project, playing in Rosemont Theater in Chicago with the huge, big orchestras. And I was thinking, when could this be happen? When is possible this to happen in Bulgaria? And it happened. Just something like it started to run this project from Chicago, what we had. So, of course, years after that with big orchestras. And traveling, I had Berlin. Convention. I attended Paris convention. I had also Copenhagen also. Almost visited yesterday Professor Klaus Strumpf. I think it's one of the faces that are making the history of bass art. He gave me a big book of double bass that we have had almost every year master classes in Michael Stein Institute with international team of professors every year. And also having many meetings and small festivals of bass in Brno during this time with Professor Jelinek, also Miloslav Gajduš was attended there. Many meetings going with our student, exchanging something like run of who is performing different repertoire concerts, listening, doing many, almost every year I'm traveling at least for two bass events attending, and this keeps you somehow in condition to be always just to be stressful of what is going on, or sure. okay, what I can do more repertoire. I mean, this summer even preparing the recital here, also coming here with my students, preparing them. It's running, and I also am now in the top of researching for having the what is contribution of Bulgarian school in Europe, what we do, how many bass players are out of the country. I think many of them are working in the many other orchestras in Europe. And I'm researching this just to build some article or some history about our school, because we have some small articles about, but just to have a more huge research about how our school has been built and how has been developed during the time of these years, because, you know, it's... I don't know what's name in English, but like we are like marathon that we are running and we are giving the to the next one.
Sure, like yeah, right, like the baton where you're passing
yes,
the baton.
Absolutely,
yeah, no, absolutely.
So I'm always I have imagination about this. That everybody has to has his own contribution of this.
Yeah.
Run, give it it, and the other one who can, go, is going on to be better and better and better and to go and. Go and the final it's never. We just go for you. We are. I think the life is something that's have a limit, but all the rest doesn't. The universe is going, and it is also very colorful of. What everybody does, because even they say, oh, he's the best. We say, no, they are not the best. Yeah. They are different, that you can always take the most wonderful part of everybody. Yeah. This is the precious way of feel everybody and to connect of his feelings and to go on and to enjoy the life and having him. But it's not that they are not the best. I wouldn't say that they are somebody is the best. Not everybody is the best.
yeah. That's great. Well, that's so exciting. It's by going and just getting all these influences.
Yes,
I mean, you bring
absolutely.
So much back to your to your teaching.
Yes.
And there is no best. It's just all good and different and interesting.
You have to give to the other.
Yeah.
For the time you have. You have to run for that. And that's why it's my goal, always running, just to have enough possibilities to do more.
Yeah,
that's why I'm always running. And I think all of us, we do. All of us. You coming from USA, and also you do a lot for us, and it is some of your absolutely own contribution for the art of double bass, really. And I enjoy. I try sometimes, it's also a question of financial question, how to travel, where to go, how to distribute. Mm-hmm. But we are trying. And I think that we are like, we have to give the tradition that we have followed to our students. Like right now I have some students around and they have to see the world and they have to go on with running.
It's great. Well, it's great.
Double bass.
Yeah, well, you're making such a contribution, and with the research and what you're doing for just music and the traditions of Bulgaria and traditions of double bass.
Yes.
And maybe just let people know a little bit, because we were just looking through some of the other things that you've written. Just tell us maybe briefly a little bit about what else you've done in terms of research for the bass.
Written research?
Yeah, like with that.
Yes, I wrote this short book about double bass traditions and future.
Mm-hmm.
And here I would like to go on also with the research I told you about the bass school in Bulgaria, and also I'm researching. I'd like to make a catalog how many Bulgarian pieces we have, compositions, because we do have many, and everything it's like somewhere in the library, and we just something like a catalog that could be existing even online they can see. What else? We have to have time also for practicing.
Right, yeah, exactly.
Always practicing. And I think that with when you have less time, you have to be more wise how to practice fast.
Sure.
Not in the fast tempo, but just better organized. And what else? Comparing, I think that there are different systems in of the schools in here in Europe and in America. It's different way of studying music. Mm-hmm. But in the end, we always are finding in the same spot. Today, for example, a beautiful performance of Frank Proto Sonata. Yeah. Number 3 by Simon. It was really...
It was something special. I was there too.
Absolutely, yes. Yeah. A very special performance. And also you see that good to existing, to have such a great composer and performer together. Yeah. And then it is planning. Doesn't matter from which part of the world it comes. It is just on the point of music and it makes you fly.
Yeah. It made me fly. It was amazing. And so special to be able to come together like this and have it.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. I just want to thank you for what you've done. I mean, you're doing great things for your country and your city and for the world of bass. And so just thank you, and many people thank you out there.
Oh,
so,
thank you. I should thank to all of you, the great friends. And I think that we have special family of double bass, you know, because when you go and travel, can you imagine that you can go to some violin player and say, give me your instrument to play in the concert?
Probably not.
Never.
That's true.
Could be happening. But you just go and you go and say, may I try your instrument? I had just my recital with somebody's instrument. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine this to do? But it happened, and this is special family. It means that we are close to each other, and this makes our world different from the others. And what else? Just keep going forward, and thank you for all what you do for us. Probably it's good to have like one online group of all bassists just to be all together. They are different, separate groups, but I think that one could make us even more united. Yeah. And what else? We are running, and I hope that we will have a lot of energy to go forward and to give the tradition to the next generation are coming and running after us. And the most important, I think, is not only to say I am, the most important to say that we are. Mm-hmm. And I am part of you, and I just do something for you, and thank you that you do something for me.
That's great. Well, thank you. Very cool. Love those tracks. One Bass, One Woman is the name of the album. Check out the show notes for that. And Petia, thank you so much for being on the show. All right. All kinds of news and all sorts of feedback. I'll share a little bit today. I'll share a little bit next episode. Thank you so much for writing in with your comments, your thoughts about the show. So much enthusiasm I get from people. I just really appreciate it. Feedback at contrabassconversations.com will get you to me. Some news. So last week, if you weren't paying attention on the podcast, I put out a couple things about it. So probably you're sick of hearing about it, but my book came out, Winning the Audition. It hit number one in auditioning on Amazon within a day of being out, which is so cool. I'm so happy to get this out there. I'm so thankful that people have been responding so positively about it. It's a project that I had no idea I'd be doing this if you'd asked me 4 or 5 months ago, but I'm really glad that this is sort of the first direction I took living out here in San Francisco is writing this book. Thank you for checking out if you have. If you haven't, winningtheaudition.net will get you there. And let me tell you, book launch week is a busy week. So I am enjoying having that done and taking a few days and just chilling out and not talking about the book all the time. Although it's a great book, you should check it out. And I was featured on Hugh Sung's webinar. Hugh Sung did a webinar with me, and that went out last week. And it'll be broadcast a few times. So I basically go through the book and talk about all the steps. I also put together a mini course where I basically break down everything that's in the book. And I'll put a link in the show notes to that. It's free. You can just go through and sort of see. It's basically what I talked about on that webinar with Hugh. So great reception for the book. It's available now, paperback, Kindle, ebook form, and I just finished recording the audiobook. So you'll be able to get that on Audible or iTunes or Amazon. It'll all be linked up. And man, let me tell you, if you want to catch those last few stinking typos in your book, do an audio narration of your book. Oh, so I thought I'd cut all, I can't tell you how many, I've had probably a dozen people look at the book, proofread it. I proofread it. You think you got it all. And then that I've learned for the next book, before you release it, do the audio version of it. You'll catch a lot. The other thing that I learned doing an audio, this is my first audiobook reading. Oh man, is that hard work, because you need to pronounce everything correctly, especially I want it to be able to link up to the Kindle version so you can do whisper sync, it's called, so you can read the Kindle version and then you can listen to the audiobook and that sort of thing. That's pretty cool technology that Amazon has, but it means you have to read it exactly perfectly. So every time you make a mistake, you gotta stop, go back. And I think the book is about 2.5 hours. It's not a super long book, but still 2.5 hours of meticulous audio is pretty wild. It makes a podcast recording seem very easy in comparison. So book launch is done. Thank you for checking it out. If you haven't, winningtheaudition.net. And I also set up, while I'm talking about this subject, I also set up a page just called support. Contrabass Conversations.com/support. As I'm saying that out loud, it sort of sounds like customer support. I hope that's not confusing. But what it is all the ways, both financial and non-financial, you can support the show. That could be making a donation, advertising with the show, buying a book, buying something through Amazon, or non-financial ways like just sharing the episodes with people that you know in your social network via email, text message. It could be contributing a transcript. If you want to do a transcript, oh, I could use help with that. I think this is what, 276, episode 276. And I think I've got like 4 of the 276 episodes transcribed. So I could certainly use help on that. It could also be leaving a review. You can leave a review for us on iTunes. You can leave a review for us on Google Play. On Amazon, you can review Winning the Audition on Amazon. Anything like that would be super helpful. And last thing about the back end yik yak about Contrabass Conversations, I've been meaning to do this for quite some time, but I set it up now. So you can just type contrabassconversations.com/. And then any social network you can think of, and it'll take you to my page there. So it could be /Twitter/Facebook/Instagram/YouTube/iTunes/Pinterest/Tumblr/Flickr, and even yes, /Snapchat. I'm on Snapchat. You go there and you get my little guy that you can scan and add me on Snapchat, which I don't use a ton, but I'm trying to do more, which is what all old people like me seem to say. But anyway, contrabassconversations.com/Facebook, Twitter, whatever, or /support if you want to learn about ways you can support the show. All right, and here's some listener feedback this week. And again, feedback@contrabassconversations.com. Shoot me an email and I will feature whatever you would like to tell me on the show. Well, maybe not whatever you'd like to tell me, but appropriate things on the show. So Matt Gold wrote in. He teaches bass at the College of William and Mary, and he's on my email list. And if you join my email list, which you can do, you'll probably be bombarded with it if you go to either ContrabassConversations.com or doublebassblog.org. But if you join my email list, you get a series of four emails spaced, I think, a week apart or something like that. Just a little bit about me and so many people. Some of you have been with me for 10 years or 10 plus years, but a lot of people, this might even be your first episode, or you've been listening for a month or a few months. So I send out just a few kind of relevant posts, including some stuff about me. So Matt got the email that says, "Did you know that my car caught fire and exploded driving home from a gig a few years ago?" And I share that. So thank you for writing in, Matt. He says, "It's the most metal thing I've ever read." So I like that a lot. And Jerry Ramos also wrote in, and he said, "Would it be possible to interview Gary Carr or Rabath? Peace, and once again, thanks." And I love messages like this because they're very easy to answer. I just told Jerry, I've interviewed both of them. Kind of, anyway. I had Gary Carr on the show. Really, Barry Lieberman was interviewing him, but he's still on the show, and it's an amazing episode. If you haven't listened to that, it's a retrospective of Gary's entire recorded career with Barry Lieberman up at the University of Washington, Seattle. And I had Rabath on the show early on. I'd love to have both of them on for a round two. That would be awesome. But you can check out both of those, and I will put a link in the show notes for both of those. And thanks for the suggestions, Jerry. And if you have any other suggestions, people, my list is around 400 people at this point, but I'm talking to a few people every week, and I love your suggestions, and I take them all and I kind of compile them together and figure out who to contact next based on what people are interested in hearing. And the last bit of listener feedback for today, and much more to share, but just kind of parsing this out here. Ray Charles wrote in. He really likes these Spotify playlists that I send out. So he says, "Your podcast and your weekly Spotify playlist are fantastic. Please keep it up. Have a great day, Jason." That's awesome, Ray. And again, if you're not on my email list, go ahead. You'll see the form if you go to ContrabassConversations.com. But if you are on my email list, every week on Monday, I send out a Spotify playlist featuring bass music. It might be somebody that I'm having on the show or that I had on the show. It might be a mix of classical music or jazz or world music or various things. I'd love to have you follow along with that. It's a lot of fun to put together, and it's just kind of a cool way of sharing music with the community. So thank you, Ray, and thank you for listening, folks. It's so great to share this content with you. So much fun to go to Prague and do these interviews, and I'm just so fortunate to be able to do what I do, and thank you for following along. I do this for all of you and for the bass community, and it's so satisfying and enjoyable, and I will really look forward to seeing you again soon for more life in the low end of the spectrum.